tomorrow for introducing me. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to my talk. Today, I'm going to talk about a practical microanalysis based on scanning electron microscopy. First, I would like to acknowledge EM Core staff, James, Hugh, Honghui, and Vasek for their help and the contributions to this presentation. The focus of my talk will be on analytical techniques, including EDS, CL, ECCI, and EBSD. I will spend most of the time on EDS because it's the most widely used techniques in SEM. Also, I will give brief introductions about other techniques. First, let me quickly review the interaction between the electron beam and the specimen. The incident beam bombards the sample and penetrates below the surface, generating different signals. From top to the bottom, we collect different signals, SE from the surface, BSE, characteristic X-ray, Bram-Schulon X-ray. If the sample is luminescent material, we can also get UVVs and IR light. Also, we can measure the specimen current to do the EBIC. We use different detectors to detect the different signals to do different analysis, such as we use SEBSE for imaging. In the red box, they are analytical techniques. We use them to do analytical characterization. Today, the focus of my talk will be on them. Let me talk about EDS first. EDS is short for energy dispersive spectroscopy. It is a powerful technique for chemical compositional analysis. It can answer three questions about your materials: what, where, and how much. First, it can tell us what kind of elements your samples have, so we can do elements identification. It's a qualitative analysis. Also, it can tell us where the certain elements are located. We can do point analysis, line scan, mapping to know the elements distribution. Also, we can know how much of certain elements on a certain scanning area, the concentration of them, then to do quantitative analysis. Why EDS? There are a lot of techniques that we can use to do chemical analysis, like XRF, XPS. Why we choose EDS? Because EDS has a lot of advantages, such as it is non-destructive detection, it requires little sample preparation, it is a fast parallel detection for different elements, it is a fast semi-quantitative analysis without standards, and it has a sub-micron spatial resolution. Also, it is a consistent measurement. Just like any other technique, it also has limitations. The energy resolution is not very high. Detection limit is about 1,000 to 3,000 ppm, not very good comparing to some other techniques. Not ideal for light elements. Quantification is not very accurate. To understand how EDS works, here I have included five subsections, focusing on different important aspects. First, let me talk about the generation of X-rays. X-rays are generated by atomic atoms that are ionized by the incoming beam. Here is a silicon atom. The incident beam bombards the sample and then knocks out the inner shell electron, leaving a hole. The electron in an outer shell fills the hole. The energy difference between the outer shell and the inner shell will be released as an X-ray, which is a characteristic X-ray. This set of a characteristic X-ray is a fingerprint of an element and can be used to identify the elements in the sample. How to name each X-ray peak? We use the inner shell and the outer shell name each one. KLM are in the shell where the hole is generated when the electron is ejected by the incident beam. Alpha, beta, gamma, they are outer shells from where the electron is filling in the hole. Now we want to know how to identify X-ray peaks. X-ray spectrum is a plot of X-ray intensity versus energy. So first, let me talk about energy axis. Each peak has a specific energy. For any given element, for example, K family X-rays have the highest energy. The energy level of K alpha is always smaller than that of K beta, as this diagram shows here. When we consider different elements, atomic number is a major factor. There is a relationship between the atomic number and the X-ray energy. It can be described by Moseley's law, which was discovered by Henry Moseley in 1913. He found the energy of characteristic X-rays varies monotonically with the increasing atomic number. And here's the formula. The energy is proportional to the square of the atomic number Z. Moseley's law is the basics of elemental analysis with EDS. These two figures show the position of X-ray peaks versus atomic number, which follows the Moseley's law very well. So now we talk about energy axis. Now let me talk about the intensity axis. The intensity of a peak represents the probability of the transition. In a given family of X-ray lines, higher energy means lower probability, therefore less intensity. This can be clearly seen in this spectrum. So copper K alpha intensity is much higher than copper K beta. The width of lines for different families are summarized on this table. For example, the K alpha to K beta ratio is about 10 to 1. This is a very useful guide when we do peak identification. Now, let me talk about the spatial resolution. For X-rays, spatial resolution means the entire interaction volume. In 1972, Everhard reviewed the size and the shape of the interaction volume. Later, people used the Monte Carlo simulation method to simulate the electron scattering and found the interaction volume was influenced by two major factors. First factor is the density of elements. The interaction volume decreases with the element number. The second factor is incident beam energy. The interaction volume increases with the beam energy. Now we have a question. Is it always a good idea to lower the beam energy to get a better spatial resolution? The answer is, it depends. We also need enough energy to excite the atom. So we also need a voltage to excite the peak sufficiently. The overvoltage is the ratio of the beam energy to the bending energy. From this figure, you can see the X-ray production increases with the increasing overvoltage. At 2.7, it has the maximum value. In practice, the overvoltage ratio should be at least 2 for efficient generation of X-rays. So come back to the previous question. For this reason, we cannot lower the incident beam energy too much. The other kind of resolution is energy resolution. It's a detector property, but it also depends on the parameters we use. I will get back to this later. Detector energy resolution is traditionally measured by the full width at half maximum of the manganese K alpha X-ray peak at 5.9 keV. Resolutions vary from 125 to 150 eV for different detectors. Here is an example. There are two different resolution detectors. When we use the left one, which has a lower resolution, the sulfur K beta was merged into K alpha as a solder. Then we used the better resolution detector for the same sample. Then the K alpha and the K beta can be resolved well. After X-rays are generated, they need to be collected for analysis. In the next section, I'm going to talk about the detection of X-ray, including detection, detector, and the signal processing. Here's a K-alpha, calcium K-alpha X-ray. So how is the X-ray energy detected? So when the calcium K-alpha X-ray, incoming X-ray, arrives to the detector, the incoming X-ray generates electron hole pairs in the silicon crystal detector. A bias voltage will separate electrons and holes to opposite sides of the crystal, generating signals. So the electrons will go to the positive side, holes will go to the negative side. So detecting the signals can tell the energy of the incoming X-ray. CD detector is a classic type of detector. CD means lithium doped silicon. Lithium doping is to create an intrinsic zone in the non-pure silicon by neutralizing impurities. Therefore, charge carries only from incoming X-ray. CD detector uses liquid nitrogen to cool the whole system down. That can suppress the lithium diffusion. The leakage current also can minimize noise, narrow the peak, and get a better resolution. At MRL, we have three SEMs equipped with EDS systems. One is a Hitachi 4700, which is a cold field emission gun SEM. It has a high resolution. Another one is Joe 6060, which is a thermionic gun SEM. It has a high beam stability. Stable beam is ideal for EDS. Also, the probe current is high and stable. The third one is Joe 7000F, which is a Schottky field emission gun SEM. It has a high resolution. Probe current is high and stable. New trend of EDS detector is SDD detector. SDD means silicon drift detector. Typically, it has a better design and it uses a ring electrode structure, so it can have a very small anode. As a result, we can get a lower noise and a better resolution. Also, the integrated amplifier can handle higher count rates without sacrificing energy resolution. From this figure, we can see when the count rate is super high for SDD, the resolution is still pretty good. On the contrary, for CD detector, when the count rate increases to 100,000, the resolution decreased very quickly. Also, SDD uses a thermal electric cooling system, so liquid nitrogen is not needed, will be more convenient. When collecting the X-ray data, it is important to be aware of any potential artifacts and understand how they arise and how they impact the experiment. In the next section, I'm going to talk about artifacts. First, be careful about a chamber scope. We use the air chamber scope to monitor the situation of the specimen chamber. The air light will interfere with the X-ray. In this spectrum, when the air chamber scope was on, air light creates a large noise and creates a very big white zero peak. After subtracting the zero peak, the tail shows as a peak close to zero. This noise also broadens X-ray peaks. Another artifact is a peak overlap. It happens when X-ray peaks have very similar energy, and the detector resolution is not high enough to resolve them. Here we have a very classic example. Sulfur-K alpha, Mu-L alpha, and Lead-M alpha, all of them have similar energies of about 2.3 keV. The three peaks overlapped and formed one wider peak. In practice, we can improve the energy resolution or use alternative peaks for analysis when peaks overlap. Here we have more artifacts. There are internal fluorescence peaks, SK peaks, and some peaks. They show up as minor peaks in the spectrum. Internal fluorescence peak and XK peaks are related and they are a pair. For example, here is the calcium K alpha major peak. Some of the energy of X-rays of this peak can be absorbed by the silicon crystal of the detector, and the silicon will be ionized and generates silicon internal fluorescence peak at 1.74 keV. At the same time, the energy of a calcium K alpha X-ray will be reduced by 1.74 keV, then generates calcium silicon XK peak. Some peak means the energies of two incoming X-rays are added together and was recorded as a sun peak in the spectrum. Sun peaks and XK peaks become more significant at high X-ray contrast, or if the dead time is more than 60%. The picture here shows us the sun peaks, the intensity will increase with the increasing dead time. So ideally, we change the parameters to keep the dead time less than 40%. After we remove the sun peaks and XK peaks, the quantification of quantitative analysis results would be more accurate. Also, we need to be careful with auto-identification. Auto-ID is convenient, but it is not always correct. In this example, the sample has many elements. When we got this spectrum, this peak was auto-identified as a chromium K-alpha. If it is a chromium K-alpha, this peak should be chromium K-beta. Previously, I talked about the width of lines. The K-alpha to K-beta ratio should be around 10 to 1. So we know this auto-ID is incorrect, and the peak, this peak, should be lanthanum L-beta 2. Now, the width of lines of L family follow the rules very well. I would like to discuss a few more practical aspects of these techniques. EDS analysis, we need a lot of cones to get good results. We can increase the probe current or beam energy to increase the contour rate and get more signals. Here is an example. When I set the probe current as H, the contour rate was about 1000. Then I changed the probe higher as 12, the cones increased a lot. Also, we want to get a higher energy resolution. Basically, we can use a longer time constant to achieve this. Time constant means signal processing time. Here is an example. When the time constant is very short, the peaks are wide. And when the time constant is much longer, the peaks are much sharper. Longer time constant is used for high resolution application. For example, quantitative analysis, or there is a peak overlap. Short time constant is for high throughput application. For example, for mapping, when we need to handle high contour rate. Here is more example about the time constant, energy resolution, and the die time. From P1 to P6, the time constant was increased. The larger time constant gives a better energy resolution, but also will increase the die time. At a high counter rate, too high that time, the CD detector cannot handle too much signals and causes detector flooding. In practice, we limited the die time below 40%. Also, there's another phenomenon about energy resolution. The resolution is a function of X-ray energy. So lower energy X-rays have higher energy resolution. For the same X-ray family, for example, here, we have K alpha X-ray peaks. Low Z element X-rays have higher energy resolution. So for elements having multiple X-ray families, we can use lower energy lines to do analysis. This is also the reason why we always use a specific energy to define the energy resolution. Traditionally, we use the manganese K alpha. What beam energy to choose? Basically, higher beam energy will benefit over voltage and the counter rate. Lower beam energy is good for improving spatial resolution and the light elements analysis. Let me talk about light elements a little bit more. They are challenging for EDS analysis because light elements have a low fluorescent yield, produce low energy X-rays, and these X-rays are easily absorbed by heavier elements, have a higher absorption effect. What can we do with the light element? I'm showing here an example. The sample is a silicon carbide. At a higher KeV, the carbon peak is hardly visible. However, if I reduce the accelerating voltage to 3 keV, the carbon peak is getting prominent. Here is another example of low beam energy analysis. It's the EDS mapping of aluminum copper interface. I changed the parameters several times and got different maps. In the first map, I used a higher beam energy. You can see the signal to noise ratio is pretty good, but the interface is fuzzy because the spatial resolution is not high enough. Then I reduced the beam energy from 20 keV to 2.5 keV. The spatial resolution was improved, but the map is noisy because the signal is lower. Also, I had to switch to copper L peak because the K peak is not excited at low energy. I boosted the beam current a lot, but I got more statistics of the signals. Finally, you can see the lower beam energy, higher probe current gives sharp interface and a clear map. Another benefit is that we can see the light elements showing up, and it is some oxide inclusion in the material. We have seen in this example to use the lower beam energy to improve spatial resolution, visualize the light elements, and we have used the alternative peak for copper at a low KeV. In addition, it can also reduce charging effect if the material is not very conductive. In this part of my talk on EDS, I would like to add some final comments about the spectrum imaging and the post-processing. Full-spectrum imaging refers to modern way of mapping. In the spectrum image, each pixel in the map contains a full X-ray spectrum. In this way, it allows us post-processing and you don't even need to know the elements in all the ones. Each energy slice of this 3D data cube gives us a map. that's how elemental map is produced. So when we do post-processing, still you can go back to the periodic table to select the missed elements. That gives a lot of flexibility. Normally, we show one map for one element. However, be careful with what you see and what you show. There are different types of maps, including cons map and the composition maps, such as atomic percentage map or weight percentage map. The cons map doesn't consider the background, the peak overlap, and didn't do quantification. Sometimes the low cons map might be misleading. For example, the calcium cons map looks different from the composition maps. To get composition maps, software needs to do quantification and converts the cons into concentration. Also, we can do phase identification. For example, in this spectrum image for 1, 2, 3 areas, we can guess different contrast may be corresponding to different phases. So I extracted the spectra from these different areas to do look very different. And we can let the software do the statistics for us and generate phase maps automatically. As shown here, this is an overlay of different phases on a single map. Now let me talk about quantification. When we do quantification, we need to compare the data from a known sample to data from a standard sample. Here's the equation, which is called Kästin's first approximation. It considers a specific element I, the concentration of element I in the unknown is the ratio, K ratio, times is the concentration in the standard. K ratio is the peak intensity ratio between sample and the standard. In reality, there are multiple elements in our sample. Every element in the sample has an effect on intensity of every peak. So this is called the matrix effect. It includes atomic number effect, absorption effect, and the fluorescent effect. Matrix effect must be corrected by a ZAF factor for each element. The ZAF factor for the standard is directly calculated in the software based on the composition. For the unknown sample, it is also calculated, but it is iterated until there is no change in calculated composition. As I have talked, for quantification, we need to compare the spectrum from our sample to spectrum taken from standards. There are two kinds of standards in the software. They are stored data from standards taken in factory, and we call them internal standards. If we use those, it is normally considered standardized, and the analysis considered semi-quantitative only. Also, we can use our own standard. In this case, we take a spectrum from standards and sample on the same instrument, and totally the same experimental condition, use the same parameters, then we can get more accurate results. There are inherent limitations in EDS quantification, which I summarized here. It requires a homogeneous sample with a flat and a smooth surface, not good for rough surface or nanoparticles because matrix effect will be completely changed. Carbon contamination is pretty common, which is also a problem. For lead elements, there are not enough X-rays and there is a strong absorption effect. In addition to EDS, there There are also other analytical techniques available that can provide useful characterization data. I will briefly discuss these techniques in the next section. Now I'm going to talk about CL, cathodoluminescence. CL can provide us the information on optical properties, electronic states, structure, and the defects of luminescent sample. Here is the CL system schematic. The incident beam passes through a small aperture in the parabolic mirror, impacts the sample, and produces emission of photons. The mirror will collect and reflect the photons into the spectrometer. We use different detectors for collecting different wavelengths of lights. We can do panchromatic CL or monochromatic CL by selecting different wavelengths which passes through the spectrometer. For panchromatic CL, we collect all the wavelengths to form images. The example here is a panchromatic CL image of a gallium nitride thin film grown on a sapphire substrate. You can see a lot of dots here. They are threading dislocations. For monochromatic CL, we only collect a certain wavelengths. The mono CL also can do spectroscopy. This is the spectrum from the same sample. On the spectrum, there are two peaks at 388 and 362 separately. Then I used these two wavelengths to do imaging. 388 nanometer comes from the triangle island, and the 362 comes from other areas. Different wavelengths come from different areas, so we can tell different areas have different optical properties. Here is another example of imaging defects by using CL. The left image is a pure gallium nitride wafer. It has less threading dislocations. The red one is a gallium nitride thin film grown on silicon substrate, and it has much more defects. CL is able to image dislocations, but it cannot do more detailed analysis. Like a Burger spectre, we can use other technique to do it, like ECCI. Now let me talk about ECCI, which stands for Electron Channeling Contrast Imaging. It's a technique for imaging crystal defects, like dislocations or stacking faults near the sample surface. It's non-destructive, can be alternative to TEM. It uses a backscatter detector in SEM based on electron channeling effect. Electron channeling happens strongly when a single set of atomic plane satisfies the Bragg's law to the incident beam, and which is called the two-beam diffraction condition. When electrons are channeling, there is less backscatter electrons bouncing back from the surface. Defects interrupt the channeling, generating more backscatter signals, and therefore produce a bright contrast. When running ECCI, we need rocking the beam to get an electron channeling pattern, ECP first, then tilt and rotate the sample to get a two-beam condition, so that only one Kikuchi line passes through the pattern center. This plane will provide the strongest channeling contrast. ECCI is operating at high beam energy. Here we can see, with increasing the incident beam energy, the ECP pattern will be getting more clear. So normally we use a 30 keV accelerating voltage. Here is an ECCI imaging example. The sample is a gallium nitride thin film growing on a silicon substrate. We can see spots with black-white contrast on the image. They are threading dislocations. the material has a hexagonal structure. The dislocations have six equivalent Fergus vector. According to G.V criterion, when this six G.V don't equals to zero, all the dislocations are visible. Then we can do calculate dislocation density or do more detailed dislocation analysis. Finally, let me talk about EBSD briefly. EBSD stands for Electron Backscatter Diffraction. The major function of this technique is to do crystal orientation determination and the phase identification. We can get about 20 to 50 nanometer spatial resolution. When we do EBSD, the sample is tilted to high angle, 70 degree. Inside the sample, electrons scatter in all directions. Those electrons satisfying Bragg's law with the lattice plane HKL will scatter strongly to form a diffraction cone. The cone intersects the screen to form a Kikuchi line. This happens for both HKL and the negative HKL, so they are a pair or a band. The Bragg's angle, theta, in this schematic appears to be pretty big. Actually, it is very small, only a fraction of a degree, less than 1 degree. So the lines are much straighter like this. And the width of the band is also inversely related to the plane spacing in the crystal. And so based on these patterns, we can determine the crystal orientation and the structure of each spot. Then we can do mapping. The sample shown here is a duplex stainless steel 3OH. It has two phases. One is BCC ferrite, one is FCC austenite. These two phases have very similar patterns and sometimes hard to identify. On the phase map up here, we can see some misindexing of phases where the BCC and the FCC were not identified correctly. After I optimized the parameters, the indexing was much improved. Basically, I refined geometry calibration, turned on advanced feed to more accurate calculation. Then I got a much clearer indexing, which however took longer time to do, like paid time penalty for better resolution. The images at the bottom left are orientation maps. So we can see there is a strong preferential orientation for both FCC and the BCC. Sample X direction is mostly along the 001 crystal orientation. Sample Z direction is mostly along 101 crystal orientation. For both phases, the crystal orientation distribution is also reflected by the inversible figure of sample Z direction for both FCC, FCC, and the BCC. Good sample preparation is extremely important for EBSD. The sample should be free of strain and stress at the surface. Strain and stress may be introduced during mechanical polishing. We need to remove them in final step of polishing. We have dedicated instruments at MRL for doing this, specifically two vibrator polisher and a broad beam iron beam polisher. In addition, if you do EBSD in VIB, you can do local VIB milling to remove a thin layer from the surface. That, however, is for very small area only. to conclude the webinar, I hope you have gained some insights into this analytical techniques in SEM beyond the basic SEM imaging. Next Thursday at the same time, Dr. Jacob Grau and Dr. Tao Shang will be presenting a seminar on micro and nano lithography. You can register at this website. If you have any questions about SEM and the related techniques, feel free to contact me or other staff. I listed their email address here. Finally, MRL is a part of the Big Four webinar series. On May 20th, Dr. Rudel Rimi will give a talk about thermal and mechanical characterization of polymers. On May 22nd, Dr. Julio Soros and Dr. Cassie Walsh will give a talk about 3D profilometry. More information on the registration can be found through this link. Now I'm happy to take any questions.